August Wilson's Ma Rainey's Black Bottom is a dramatization of real blues legend Ma Gertrude Rainey recording Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. Say that five times fast. Ma Rainey is considered the queen of blues. Though she hasn't received the recognition of her counterparts, Ma Rainey was very instrumental in the blues genre, along with her mentee Bessie Smith and Billie Holiday. She's credited with influencing the likes of Janis Joplin, Ray Charles, and Louis Armstrong as well. Ma Rainey began performing professionally at the age of 14 when she joined vaudeville. While many other blues singers simply covered the hits, Ma Rainey is credited with writing about one-third of her songs. Despite Viola Davis's amazing performance as Ma Rainey in the Netflix original, there is no doubt that the late Chadwick Boseman stole the show in this film for many watchers, myself included. Levee is just as troubled as he is talented, battling his own demons and the prejudice that he has violently faced for his entire life. The candor with which Boseman played this character was just amazing to see. He really made this film. The character design in the entire film is really great, especially when it comes to Levee. His very presence juxtaposes that of the band and in some ways parallels that of Ma Rainey herself. I think I'll talk about Ma Rainey another time, so let's talk about Levee. Ma Rainey's band is made up of four men: Toledo, Cutler, Slow Drag, and Levee. All of the men wear tuxedos for their stage performance, giving them more of a uniform and professional look. However, they wear full suits for the rest of the film. The film is set in the 20s during the reign of the casual suit, but prior to the zoot suit taking prominence, so the suits were well fitted. Suits were worn for most occasions unless you were a blue collar worker. Notice how the band takes off their jackets when rehearsing, but put them back on when they go to record. My thought is that wearing the jackets makes them look a bit more professional. This is in direct contrast to Ma Rainey, who wears slippers during these scenes. Their suits were also made of quite heavy fabric when compared to the fabric of suits today. Many people believe that black suits were really popular at the time, but in reality, men mostly wore gray, brown, dark green, or dark blue suits, with white suits being more welcome in the summer. The other members of the band wear pinstripe suits, with Toledo wearing a traditional three-piece tan pinstripe suit. Despite their suits being different colors, they still look pretty uniform. That is, until we get to Levee. Levee's style is very different from that of his bandmates, and not just because of his shoes, which we'll get to in a moment. First, he wears a gray plaid vest that matches with his plaid gray slacks, a white and blue striped shirt, a black and tan patterned tie, black and white striped socks, and a black pinstripe jacket. None of that matches. He wears his hair parted on the side, and he either wears a fedora or a Homburg hat when he's outside. I can't really tell the difference between those styles. The more adventurous and mismatched style of his clothing reflects his personality and his desire to take a risk that the other band members aren't willing to take. He is willing to lose his job as Ma's trumpet player in order to risk it all writing songs for Sturdivant and putting his own band together. Though the Harlem Renaissance was in full swing by this point as a Southern trumpet player, Levee didn't have guaranteed income outside of Ma's employment. Such mismatched clothing also gives me the vibe that he is a bit unhinged, like the trauma he has experienced is driving him off the deep end very quickly, which is unfortunately what we see at the end of the film.
That's the only way.
What I want to know is, he a man of God. Where the hell was God when all this was going on? Why didn't God strike down them crackers with some of this lightning you talking about to me?
From this scene, we know that Levee doesn't believe in God, and as the film continues, he becomes increasingly angry with those around him. He's a shapeshifter with no belief system, no family, and no friends, which makes him dangerous. Now let's talk about shoes. Shoes are incredibly important symbols in this film, with Levee's shoes being the most important. The first time we see them, they are in the store window, and Levee buys them for $11, which is a week's pay, and equates to about $175 today. In my opinion, this is a lot to spend on shoes, especially when you're in the middle of planning a career transition that may or may not work out, like Levee was. This mirrors the way Ma talks to Dessie Mae about buying her new shoes, which is not surprising since Levee makes it clear that he looks up to Ma, even if he doesn't act like it. He admires the way that she does whatever she wants and makes a good living from her music, while he has to code switch and change his personality, which the band gives him flack for.
Telling me I'm spooked up by the white man. You let one mess with me, I'll show you how spooked up I am.
The man come in here, call you a boy, tell you to get up off your ass and rehearse it. You ain't had nothing to say except, yes, sir.
I can say yes, sir, to whoever I please. What you got to do with it? I know how to handle white folks. I've been handling them for 32 years. Now you gonna tell me how to do it? Just because I say yes, sir, don't mean I'm spooked up by them. I know what I'm doing. As soon as I get my band together and record them songs Mr. Sturdivant told me I can make, I'm gonna be like Ma and tell the white man just what he can do. Ma tell Mr. Irvin she leaving, Mr. Irvin get down on his knees and beg her to stay. That's the way I'm gonna be. Make the white man respect me.
I would also argue that he probably thinks of his mother when he looks at Ma. Levee was permanently scarred trying to save his mother from a group of white men, but Ma gets to talk to them however she pleases, which is not only evident how she speaks to Sturdivant and Irvin, but how she speaks to a police officer on the street.
I don't know why you want to tell that lie.
Lady, will you let me tell the story?
Well, if you're going to tell it right.
Ma has a certain power and agency that Levee has been dreaming of since he was young. Back to the shoes. The shoes are Oxfords, which rose to prominence at the time over lace-up dress boots, which had been the most popular choice previously. However, Levee shoes are bright yellow wingtips, a direct contrast to the black, brown, or white shoes that were more common, and even in contrast to his own clothing. It seems like he wants to be more innovative and inventive, just like he does with his music. The shoes are a point of pride for him, which is why he's so upset when Slow Drag and Toledo step on them.
Damn! Slow Drag, watch them big ass shoes you got.
Why ain't nobody done nothing to you?
You done stepped on my shoes?
Then move them the hell out the way then. You was in my way, I wasn't in your way.
Any man who takes a whole week's pay and puts it on some shoes, you understand what I mean? What you walk around with on the ground with is a fool, and I don't mind telling them.
What difference it make to you, Cutler?
Not only are they a symbol of his arrogance, but their yellow color is also a symbol of his cowardice. He doesn't stand up to Sturdivant. Instead, he goes after Toledo, who is the oldest of the group. Despite how much we sympathize with Levee because of his rough upbringing and Sturdivant stealing his music, we can't brush over the fact that he's a coward. Toledo also mentions how he has been where Levee is. In his youth, he made a lot of the same mistakes that Levee had. In a way, killing Toledo not only meant that Levee was killing his career and his freedom, it meant that Levee was killing himself. As the film progresses, Levee begins to look more and more disheveled. His tie is loosened, he looks as if he's lost confidence, and his eyes look wide, wild, and almost rabid. When he stabs Toledo, he begins to cry and continues talking to him as if he doesn't truly understand what he's done. But eventually, he sits down and begins to bear the brunt of his actions. Film critic Odie Henderson wrote these words about Boseman's performance. He said, "Boseman knew he was dying when he performed this monologue, and some of the things he's saying as Levee sound like questions one would ask oneself if facing one's own mortality." Suddenly, the emotions become too real. Boseman practically levitates with hurt and rage, committing to the moment with a ferocity that's as brilliant as it is painfully unwatchable. I know it's just acting, but for me, reality intervened in that moment, and I saw something transcendent. This is editing Jane cutting in here. I just read this Cinema Blend article about Glenn Turman and Coleman Domingo and their experience on set with Chadwick Boseman. Apparently, Chadwick Boseman took the initiative to learn the trumpet for this role, even though it was not required of him.
That's to get the people's attention.
Excuse me? This quote from Coleman Domingo says,
"He truly learned to play. I think everyone was like, oh, that's what you're doing, Chad? Okay, now I'm gonna learn too." I love that he's like, yeah, I'm gonna challenge you. We're gonna challenge each other.
Glenn Turman, who is one of my favorite actors ever, also said,
"We were all staying in the same hotel. It started sounding like, you know, a music school. You get up the elevator, you could hear Chadwick, you know, he's working on it. It made you say, hey, I don't wanna practice right now, but I better get to start practicing."
What an interesting and charismatic and influential person who was just being himself and did not even, I think, understand how much he really truly affected everyone around him. People like you and me who never even met him. Just so interesting. Levee's costume design really complemented Boseman's acting in this role and painted the character as someone that we sympathize with, but that we recognize as desperate and unpredictable. Chadwick Boseman bodied this role and created something that is, in the words of Henderson, transcendent.